Ellarigu namaskara. Good afternoon all. A very warm welcome to all of you who have joined us online and offline as a part of special Swachh Bharat campaign from 2nd to 31st October 2021 and to commemorate 152nd birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhiji. ICRIAHR is organizing a guest lecture on the topic Gandhian philosophy and science by novelist and Professor Dr. Ken Ganeshaya. First, let us listen to the ICR song followed by IAHR jingle.
जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की सुखद प्रतीक हरित भारत की कृषि धन पशु धन मानव जीवन दुग्ध मत्स्य फल यंत्र सुवर्धन वैज्ञानिक विधि नव तकनीके पारिस्थितिकी का संरक्षण शस्य श्यामला छवि भारत की जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की हिम प्रदेश से सागर तट तक मरुधरती से पूर्वोत्तर तक हर पथ पर है मित्र कृषक की शिक्षा शोध प्रसार सकल तक आशा स्वावलंबित भारत की जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की।
Thank you. It is really amazing to have an eminent speaker, Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya, with us today. So may I request Dr. B.N.S. Murthy, Director, to kindly welcome our today's chief guest, Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya. Professor, novelist, traveler, Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya is an agriculture scientist, retired professor, Dean, U.S. Bengaluru. Presently, he is a national advisor at Indian Bioresource Information Network. He has established a world-renowned research organization called ATRI, Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and the Environment. He is also a novelist specialized in thrillers or fiction novels, writes in Kannada. He is from Kotiganahalli, Kolar district, Karnataka. He pursued his BSc Agri, MSc Agri in Genetics and Plant Breeding and PhD in Botany from US Bangalore. Dr. Ganeshaya is a prolific scientific author. He has published more than 200 scientific papers, edited 11 books, authored and contributed several book chapters, reference CDs, and popular articles. Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya has contributed to the literature of Kannada language. He has published many novels and short story collections. To name a few novels, Kanaka Musuku, Karisiriyana, Kapilipisara, Chitadanta, ಏಳು ರೊಟ್ಟಿಗಳು, ಮೂಕಧಾತು, ಶಿಲಾಕುಲ ವಲಸೆ, ಬಳ್ಳಿಕಾಳ ಬೆಳ್ಳಿ, ರಕ್ತಸಿಕ್ತ ರತ್ನ. ದ ನೇಮ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ನಾವೆಲ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಆರ್ ಸೋ ಎಕ್ಸೈಟಿಂಗ್. ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ರಿಟನ್ ಟೂ ವಾಲ್ಯೂಮ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಜರ್ನಿ ಇನ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದೇರ್ ಆನ್ ಟು ದ ಲಿಟ್ರೇಚರ್. ನೇಮ್ಲಿ ಸಸ್ಯಸಗ್ಗ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಜರ್ನಿ ಇನ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿವಿಸುಳಿ ಜರ್ನಿ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಟು ಲಿಟ್ರೇಚರ್. ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ರಿಸೀವ್ಡ್ ಸೆವರಲ್ ಹಾನರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅವಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಫೆಲೋ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ಸೈನ್ಸಸ್ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು फेलो इंडियन नेशनल साइंस एकेडमी न्यू दिल्ली फुल ब्राइट फेलोशिप, फेलो नेशनल अकाडमी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर साइंसेस न्यू दिल्ली, फेलो करंट साइंस एसोसिएशन बेंगलुरु. ही हैज रिसीव्ड कर्नाटक साहित्य अकाडमी दत्ति अवार्ड फॉर द नॉवल कनक मुसुकु एंड परिसर प्रशस्ति फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फॉरेस्ट इकोलॉजी एनवायरमेंट गवर्नमेंट ऑफ कर्नाटक. विद दिस ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन मे नाउ इनवाइट अवर टूडे स्पीकर डॉक्टर के एन गणेश अय्यर टू शेयर हिज wisdom on the topic of Gandhian philosophy and science. I handing over to you, sir.
It's in fact a pleasure to be introduced by another Kolarian. I am from Kolar and I was told she is also from Kolar. I feel doubly proud that another colleague from Kolar is introducing me. Thank you, Jaimala. It was wonderful. But I didn't know that you perhaps have done so much research into my bio data. I don't know where you got all these details. I also would like to now apologize for some of you who wanted to be in front of your computer listening to the talk if you have been forced to come here. It's my fault. The reason being the following. I somehow do not like talking into the computer with the assumption that the people on the other side are actually listening to me while they actually could be sleeping. So I wanted to make sure that at least some of you are here physically so that at least my vociferous voice will at least wake you up and keep you listening to my talk. I'm sure all of you would realize that a speaker would enjoy giving his talk only when he finds that the listeners on the other side are attentive to him. When he's not sure about it, there won't be any enthusiasm and spirit in delivering the lecture. So I requested Tejaswini that I would rather take the trouble of coming all the way here and deliver a face-to-face talk than sitting in front of my computer in the house and talking to the wall there. And so I took the trouble of coming all the way from my house to here. So I don't really feel guilty. I have moved from your lab to here. Even then, please excuse me if I forced you to come over here. The third thing I want to talk before I begin my talk is the weakness of the teachers. I am one among those who suffer from those weaknesses. The weakness of a teacher is that when a student asks something, he can't say no. And so here, the student is Tejaswini, who asked me over the phone that I should deliver a talk. I couldn't say no to her and I agreed. The reason I'm telling about this is that I don't know why I agreed, because I am neither a Gandhian nor have read anything in the philosophy of Gandhi, except for the fact that when I was studying my BSc degree, all my colleagues used to call me Gandhi. That's the only link between me and my, and Gandhi. But nevertheless, as I told, students are, a kind of powerful candidates who can make the teacher bend down to the request, and so Tejaswini has made that. I will try to see if I can make some meaning out of the title that she asked me to deliver on. She asked me that I should speak on science and Gandhian philosophy. I added another term called science and culture and Gandhian philosophy. But as you all know, I am not going to talk on the entire science. Being a biologist, I can only speak on the science of biology and Gandhian philosophy. And in particular, since some of you know that I've been spending my last 20, 30 years in studying evolution, so I'll be now speaking on Gandhi and evolution. Let us start with the two important teachings that Gandhi proposed or at least put forward. One among them, as you all know, is non-violence. In fact, if you want to now borrow his statements, he says non-violence is a weapon of the strong. That is, those who are poor or weak only use the violence, but people who are very strong use non-violence, is his statement. The meaning or implication of that is that violence is the tool of the weak and non-violence is the tool of the strong. He also told, and this is very important, non-violence and truth are inseparable. Gandhi actually now stressed a lot on truth. And Gandhi says, non-violence and truth are inseparable. What is the meaning of this or implication of that? The implication of that is that if non-violence is truth, that means non-violence is actually real or natural, and violence is actually not real. In other words, non-violence seems to be the most natural thing in the world and violence seems to be non-natural in the world. Is it correct? Now, I am going to oppose this argument of Gandhi throughout my talk, as you will see. And hence Gandhi told, why? Gandhi, because he believed in the fact that non-violence is the real truth or is separable, not separable from the truth, he proposed that we should practice non-violence. The second important, I'll come to other things of Gandhi's principles, but the second important thing is the sacrifice. He also proposed that we should sacrifice. There's a story behind it. I will not perhaps go into the story for the sake of time, but in case if it is required, I'll perhaps now talk about it. In a sense, let us take these two elements of Gandhi's principles or Gandhi's philosophy of non-violence and sacrifice. Let us see if these two are really philosophies that we can combine as one unit. To take this argument further, let us consider the honeybee colony. I'm sure all of you know honeybee colony. Honeybee colonies occur in swamps of several hundred, sometimes lakhs. And whenever an invader attacks a honeybee colony, you all know that honeybees get out and they now start attacking the invader, the enemy. And what happens in the process? They bite, the invader is chased away, and in the process, the colony is saved. So bees attack the invaders, which is a violent act, as you all know. Bees are actually using the violence to chase away the invader. And what is more important is that by using this violence, the bee is actually protecting the colony, is defending the colony. So on one part, the first philosophy that Gandhi told that we should be non-violent is now overruled by bees here. But let us look at the other component of the same act of the bee. What is the other component? There is a cost of this defense mechanism to the honeybee. There is a sacrifice that the honeybee is doing. What is that? Whenever a honeybee bites, you all know that its sting is stuck to our body. And when it goes off from the enemy, a part of the whole anal part of the body is stuck with the enemy's tissue. So much so, as you can see there, so much so that some parts or organs of the honeybee are also left behind. And in the process, inevitably, honeybee dies. In other words, when it stings, it ends its life. On one hand, it is involving in a violent act, in chasing away the enemy. But on the other hand, it loses its organs. The sting remains in the body of the enemy. And in a few moments, the bee dies. In some sense, the honeybee is sacrificing its whole life for defending the colony. Now go back to the two principles of Gandhi. On one hand, he told you should be non-violent. On the other hand, he told you should sacrifice. But look at here, the honeybee which is involved in the violent act of chasing away the enemy is actually sacrificing its whole life. And so it does appear that there is a kind of opposite, elements of the non-violence and the sacrifice. Well, Gandhi told you have to be non-violent and you have to be sacrificed. Here is an example of a honeybee where because it is non-violent, it is sacrificing its whole life. And why is it sacrificing? It is sacrificing for protecting the entire colony. However, honeybee may have an alternate, available to it. What is that? Remain non-violent. Don't bite the enemy at all. So what would happen if it doesn't attack? It can save itself, it can save its life. By that, it is actually being selfish. Because by attacking, it is dying. By not attacking, it can save its whole life. That way, honeybee becomes selfish. Remember, Gandhi's one of the principle is also that you should not be selfish. So even if it bites, even if it doesn't bite, the consequence, the second consequence of honeybee's activities seems to be contradicting to the two principles of Gandhi, that is be non-violent and be sacrificing, or be non-violent and don't be selfish. Both of them are not possible at all. In other words, there seem to be a dichotomy, dvandva, that is a correct word in Kannada. There is a dvandva in the philosophy that Gandhi actually preached. But on the other hand, honeybee cannot do the second action. What is the second action? That it cannot be remaining silent. It cannot now be non-violent. It cannot remain simply keep quiet when the invader attacks, because the behavior of attacking an enemy has become an innate activity of the honeybee, because that is how the honeybee has evolved. So honeybee is a victim of evolution. Honeybee has been shaped to now bite whenever the enemy comes about, and so it has to be non-violent, but in the process it is sacrificing, it is not selfish. So you see that there is a conundrum of the elements that are incorporated into this one behavior of the honeybee. The reason why I am talking about honeybee is the following. You might say, oh, there's honeybee. After all, Gandhi told for the human beings. And so we should now separate the two. Don't confuse us. There is a way that one would like to argue. Now, let us not forget that what honeybee does is also done by some of the human beings. Take the example of a soldier. What is a soldier's responsibility? Soldier also sacrifices just as the honeybee sacrifices. In fact, one of the best statements that I've read about soldiers is that a true soldier fights not because he hates the enemy in front of him, but because he wants to protect the people behind him. He is sacrificing for the people on whom, you know, people are depending on him. So the entire country's population is dependent on the soldiers. And so soldier is now going and facing his own life. He's sacrificing his own life for the sake of the entire country's population. So just as a bee colony, a honeybee is now trying to defend its colony by biting the enemy, a soldier is also now defending the entire country by being violent. Don't forget that. And if you want to now call soldiers' action violent, there is also sacrifice in the soldiers' activity. The two components of Gandhi's philosophy that are contradicting to each other. So should we now then accept Gandhi's philosophy? Throughout this whole talk, you will perhaps see this tone of mind that I am trying to now contradict what Gandhi told. And there is a reason why I am trying to now contradict it. Because the talk that I am going to give today is science and Gandhi's philosophy. You will see that if you now look through the eyes of the science, especially eyes of biology, biological evolution, you will see most of Gandhi's principles, most of Gandhian philosophy cannot be executed by the human beings. I'll also give you the reason and solution for that. So let us compare the two. As we know, honeybee protects the colony, and so it has to bite and indulge itself in violent activity. So also a soldier protects the entire country, so it has to be indulging in the violent activity. Note that in both of them there is sacrifice. Honeybee is also sacrificing and soldier is also sacrificing, but also note that both of them are indulging in violence. Now, both of Gandhi's preachings are tied as inseparable actions in this examples of soldier and the honeybees. Now, what are we now doing? I mean, we all actually are paying our taxes to build up the army at the border. By that, what are we doing? We are promoting the soldiers to now sacrifice for us. But by promoting that, don't forget, we are actually telling them also to now indulge in violence. On one hand, we are celebrating Gandhi's, 150th anniversary, birthday. And we are now trying to promote Gandhi's principles. But deep in the entire system of our, regulation and governance, we are promoting the violent component of Gandhi by paying tax to now maintain soldiers in the borders. So we are all actually opposing Gandhi's principles. Should we prevent this violence? Because Gandhi has told, should we now stop building our army? If we now prevent them to now sacrifice for our purpose, what is that we are doing? We are doing a kind of an action of a submission of the entire country to the enemy to be killed by. And so should we now do that? As a matter of fact, in that sense, if you now look at the Gandhian principles through the evolution or lens of evolution, you see that there is a dichotomy that you cannot simply accept Gandhian principles on the face value of it. So in other words, Gandhi preached non-violence. Accordingly, the message to the soldier that we'll be sending out is, do not kill our enemies, which is a very absurd thing to do. And how appropriate that message will be? It will be only as appropriate or as illegal or, sorry, not as illegal, as inappropriate or illogical as to tell to a honeybee worker not to bite an enemy when it attacks it. For honeybee, it is a survival strategy. That's why it goes and bites the enemy. And so also for the soldier, it is a responsibility. It is a survival strategy, otherwise which the enemy would now kill him and he would die on the border. And so, in some sense, the defense mechanism of the honeybee or of the soldier are actually the responsibilities and the consequences of the task for which they evolved. And we cannot simply now say, don't indulge in violence. However, when I speak like this, I'm sure some of you might be already thinking in your mind, no, that is not what Gandhi told. You are twisting your philosophy of the Gandhi. What Gandhi told would be something different. I mean, that is a kind of argument one would follow. What is that argument that they might give? I will tell you. Gandhi's preaching is good for the entire world, and Gandhi wanted to now see the entire mankind as one, and don't bring that level of philosophy to honeybee and soldier and cell and tell that Gandhi's principles cannot be adopted at all. In other words, Gandhi's preaching is for global peace and oneness of mankind. Don't dissect that out into a small, you know, irrelevant behavior of a soldier. Could be one of the arguments that people might put. But what is the implication of such an argument? The implication of such an argument is that entire mankind is one. But is entire mankind one? If entire mankind is one, only then we can eliminate the war, and not if entire mankind is divided into countries. We know that entire mankind is not one, and in fact there are boundaries between human beings. And if at all, if you want to now follow what Gandhi told as stated there in the first line, that is, entire mankind is one and the global peace should be there, there should be no army. If that has to be followed, there should be no boundaries at all between the countries. If this is what Gandhi's preaching is, did Gandhi really follow this preaching on his own? Let us look at in the context of what Gandhi did. Did Gandhi believe in one nation theory? Obviously not, because at this position, what position? In trying to now see that the entire humankind is one, Gandhi actually has aligned himself with the theory of evolution. I'll tell you why and how. Now let us go back and see this statement that we thought. What is that? If Gandhi's philosophy has to be accepted as one humankind or one kindness, one kind or one human population, global peace can exist only when world is one nation, if that is the argument that Gandhi is proposing. In fact, Gandhi is aligning with the principles of evolution. How? The theory of evolution says that genetically related groups, for instance, brothers, cooperate among themselves and they fight against the other group which are competing with that group for the resources. For instance, brothers would cooperate among themselves and fight with the cousins. However, when brothers and cousins join together, they are likely to fight with another family which are less related to them and protect their interests versus the other's interests. At another level, all the families of a village join together and they fight with a neighboring village for safeguarding the territory of that village and go on building this hierarchy. At the country level, all the people of a country defend themselves and fight with another country. This is the consequence of evolution, and that's why the social and the biological evolution has led to these different groups and different evolutionary boundaries. Not evolutionary, political boundaries. In other words, genetically related individuals favor among themselves and are prompted to fight against unrelated groups. That's why countries fight among themselves. And what did Gandhi did? Gandhi, do not forget, fought for our independence. If Gandhi really now proposed the peace of oneness of the mankind, then he should not have actually fought for the independence of the country. Note that Gandhi aligned himself with the group theory of evolution because he believed in the concept of India as a country. Otherwise, why should he have fought for the independence? Why should he support the Quit India movement? And also note that Gandhi promoted the Indian army, Indian population or Indian people as the soldiers to go and fight in the Second World War. Hierarchically, you see that Gandhi is also now accepting the concept of country, India as a country. And that's why he fought for independence. If he had fought for independence, he could not now propose that the entire human population is one. If he was proposing the entire human population as one, then he could not have, or he should not have, fought for the independence of the country. You see the dichotomy that we see in Gandhian principles. In fact, he approved, or he said yes to this proposal of sending Indian army to fight in the Second World War because he believed in this hierarchical group theory of evolution. What is that? I have to protect my group, that is the country, and my group, if it helps the Indian group or the British group in the Second World War, Britishers will help us in getting the independence. And that is a kind of principle he adopted. In other words, the hierarchical nature of the related groups helping each other and fighting against the other groups was in fact adapted by Darwin to that extent. And sorry, by Gandhi, to that extent, Gandhi believed in this evolutionary principle. Thus, you see that there is a dichotomy in his preaching. At one level, we all appreciate Gandhi because he spoke of peace and spoke of oneness of the humankind and country, I mean, world without boundaries of the countries. But on the other hand, he is now also fighting for the country level independence. There is a dichotomy in this whole of these preachings. And the reason why we find this dichotomy is because all his preachings are antithetic to human evolution. And whenever he aligned with human evolution or evolutionary principle, we see that Gandhi is contradicting himself in his thinking. Now, let me go out and trace why there is antithetic thinking in the Gandhian philosophy versus the, you know, biological evolution. We know that we are a consequence of the evolution from monkey to chimpanzee to ancient man or the, yeah, and nomadic man and human and to the present Homo sapiens. Because we are the ultimate consequence of this entire change in the evolution or entire sequence of evolutions, all the animistic features of the monkeys are incorporated into us. We are just nothing but shaven monkeys without a tail. We're all monkeys, just that we don't have hair on the body as a monkey has, and we don't have the tail. Of course, we will now speak better with the groups like this, and monkeys may not speak as better, though they also communicate. Do not also forget the fact that we are a consequence of a continuous evolution from microorganisms to monkeys and then to the human beings, which means all the Darwinian fight, struggle for existence that was there in the evolution of the entire life from microorganisms to the present is all incorporated into us. We are a consequence of this continuous evolution. And in the continuous evolution, what has been going on? Evolution of selfishness, struggle for existence, violence, and all that. How can we be now divided of all this, having, you know, lived for millions of years with all these features, and then say that Gandhian principles have to be adopted? Now, evolution has shaped human beings to be very selfish, and evolution also has shaped human beings to be very violent, and without that, animal wouldn't have survived and human beings wouldn't have survived. But Gandhi's philosophy is exactly opposite of what evolution has shaped us to be. We are shaped to be selfish, otherwise we wouldn't have survived. We are shaped to be violent, but here comes Gandhi and tells us, don't be selfish and don't be violent. You see, there is a biological innateness in us, and there is a preaching imposed on us by the Gandhi. And as scientists and as human beings, we are always facing this dichotomy, this dvandva in adopting Gandhian philosophy. In other words, what Gandhi is doing is actually to adopt an anti-evolutionary behavior in all of us. And to adapt an anti-evolutionary behavior in us is not so easy. And that's why we have difficulty in adapting Gandhian philosophy. We all are evolved to be selfish and violent and greedy. And if you want to know, adapt a philosophy which is preached by Gandhi, which is against the biological evolution, it is very, very difficult. And that's why we all can't be Gandhis. In fact, Gandhi's preachings are so much antithetic to the natural process of evolution that there are two forces fighting within us. One force, the biological evolution, forcing us to do the way that we have been shaped to. And the other hand, Gandhian preachings, now don't be an evolutionary animal, be a kind human being. And there is this fight going on within us every moment when we think of Gandhi's principles. What I'm going to do now is slightly different. Whenever I speak of Gandhi, in the way that I spoke so far, I generally am taken very wrongly in the sense that people think that I'm an anti-Gandhian. But actually, if you look at the range of philosophers, starting from Buddha or Gandhi or any such great philosophers, there is a lot of commonality among them, and all of them follow the same kind of principles. Let me now trace the commonalities between these great people like Gandhi and Buddha, and then trace whether all of them are anti-evolutionary, in some sense anti-evolutionary of the science of evolution. So why is that their teachings are so famous? Let us see the commonality between them, and I'll skip this slide, and let us look at the commonalities between them and see what are all the elements that they all have taught us, and why is that because of those preaching, they have become famous, and why is that we now respect them despite the fact that we can't really follow them. Number one, One among, I mean, as I already told, one among the principles they are preaching, they taught is non-violence, compassion. We have to leave desires. And now Buddha told, desire is the root cause of all our pains. And they also told, don't be selfish. And they also propose that we need to lead a simple life. These are the elements that Gandhi or Buddha or any philosopher would teach us. In general, these are the commonalities among all the preachings. Let us take one by one and analyze why is that they preached this, and why is that because of this they have become famous, and why is that it is difficult for us to actually adapt them. Take the one among them. So let us now take one each one among them. In Marbakinelli. ಎರಡ್ ಸಲ ಓದ್ಬೇಕಾ? ಇಲ್ಲ, ಮೂರ್ ಸಲ ಓದ್ದೆ, ಬರ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಓಕೆ, ಲೆಟ್ ಅಸ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಒನ್ ಅಮಂಗ್ ದೆಮ್. ಐ ಎಮ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ನೌ ಟೇಕ್ ಒನ್ ಬೈ ಒನ್. ಲೀವ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್. ಬೋತ್ ಬುದ್ಧ ಟೋಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಗಾಂಧಿ ಟೋಲ್ ವಿ ಶುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ನೌ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್. ನೌ ವೇರ್ ಡಿಡ್ ಅವರ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ ಕಮ್ ಫ್ರಮ್? ಅಫ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ಯು ಆಲ್ ನೋ ದ ಫೇಮಸ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಬೈ ಗಾಂಧಿ, ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಎನಫ್ ಫಾರ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್ಸ್ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ಬಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಗ್ರೀಡ್. This statement has become very famous. This statement has become very famous because we're all greedy. If you are not all greedy, this statement wouldn't have become very famous at all. So this is a famous statement. And why did man become greedy? So that Gandhi had to tell this. Is there anything that is wrong with human beings? Let us go back to analyze a small behavior of the ants. How ants store the food. If you look at ants, the way they store the food, look at this one simple diagram here, or I mean illustration here. This group of ants are carrying almost 50 times to 100 times more weight than their own body. And what are they carrying for? To store that food in their nest for the future. So ants have evolved to now carry food much higher than their whole weight, to be stored for future. And in fact, human beings also exhibit the same kind of behavior. Whenever an opportunity comes to them to steal or, you know, burgle, they also carry much more heavier things than their own weight, to be now stored and stolen and stored. And this behavior of ants, as you can see, is very much evident in, for instance, in the way ants collect the seeds and actually waste them. You might have seen this in the rainy season. They now throw out the seeds outside their nests. You know, millions of seeds should be now thrown out of the nest. And why are they thrown out? Because they have not used those grains. In fact, there is a very interesting study by two scientists. What they have done is they have collected the seeds that are gathered by the ants and stored in the nest. And they find that they collect very small size to the large size seeds. And among them, the seeds that they actually and generally use are only the small sized ones, but they also collect the large sized seeds. And these people also go about and study what are the seeds that they use in the nest and what are the seeds they store for the future. Surprisingly, they always use very small seeds for the regular survival. Though they have collected the large seeds, they retain them in their nest for the future and they are hardly used at all. Now, this is the size of the seed from small to the large. This is the percentage of the seeds retained in the nest after using. As you can see, the percentage of the seeds of the large ones is always high retained in the nest. Why? Because they always use the small size seeds. Now, whenever I see this graph, I remember the way our ladies, with due apologies to them, store their saris. You all know that they might have about 10 to 50, depending on the ladies, 10 to 50 saris. And among them, a small proportion of them will be very, very rich saris. They will never open them. They will always now keep them to be now stored for the future. The future may never come. They may not even wear, but they'll be now keeping them very safe. And what are the saris they use? The saris they use are 200 rupees, 300 rupees, 1000 rupees saris every day. The most costliest saris they never use. And why has this behavior emerged? This behavior has emerged because of the way ants actually also use the seeds. They collect all kinds of seeds, but look at what the scientists have found. The seeds that ants use are smaller than the seeds that they store. So ants have developed evolutionarily this behavior of storing for the future the most valuable things and use the most invaluable or less valuable things almost regularly, and that is the source or the origin of the greediness among the animal systems. We are no different. I only showed the example of the ladies, and men are no different. If you go back to your cupboard and see the dresses, the one dress that you value the more, the coat that you might have worn only for your marriage, you never use. You will always keep it for an occasion. Maybe you will use only for 5 or 10 times in your life. But the rest of the other dresses we use are very common things. Why is that? Greediness, storage, holding. Holding for the future with the idea that we have millions of years to now live by, and we need to now conserve those dresses. And look at these birds that are now storing or holding the seeds. The holding or the greediness is there among the birds, among the chipmunks, in almost every other animal that we see. And that's why we collect so much of junk in our store yards. And here is a photo of a Philippines lady. I'm sure all of you know about this lady who died. She had about 300 shoes. And sadly, at the time when she died, one of her shoes had come out of her legs, as you can see there. So in other words, we all have evolved to be holders. We all have evolved to be greedy. And our greediness is not just because we are different from other animals. It is the animal nature of the humans that has actually come into us. Our desire to acquire wealth is shaped by evolution. And it is difficult to throw away this feature. This is instinctive to us. And Gandhi tells us to now throw away these millions of evolution of behavior. How can we do that? That is the most difficult thing to do. Then Gandhi's principle, in other words, seems to be antithetic. And let us look at the simple life that Gandhi and Buddha suggested that we should now live. Now, again, you see that the idea of leading a simple life is again very difficult. Gandhi called, of course, for a simple life. In fact, Gandhi himself adopted this simple life. Very peculiarly, if you see carefully throughout his life, his stature went on growing as he became simpler and simpler. Don't forget, Gandhi was not a simple man. In his early age, he was not very simple. Look at his dress at a very young age. He has a coat, he has a hat. And even when he was young in Africa, he was wearing coat and tie. But only later he now developed this idea of simplicity. And as I told, more and more simple he became, more and more stature his, his personality grew up or was identified with. So more he hugged the simple life, the more his stature grew. And through his life, he also proposed that we all should now adopt simple life. But that's not what we all do. We flaunt, we show off. If there is an occasion, we now try to say as much as possible to now show off ourselves in any occasion. And why did we do that? And why do we do that? This again has not come from just us. It is actually coming from animals, the animal form of the humans. Here is a bird. In fact, there is a paper in Nature that has showed that birds, when they construct the nest, they are very, very specific in the material that they choose. Look at this bird. It has chosen the same color of material to build its nest. And when it also decorates the nest with something very special like feather or something, that also is of the same color. It is not just in this case. Look here. There is another bird which always now constructs the nest only with the brown colored material, and it finds a brown colored doll with the hairs. It has flicked that and has taken and decorated its nest. Ants adorn their nest mouth with beautiful adornments and also beautiful feathers. So adorning or decorating or flaunting has evolved in humans for a long time. And why is this decoration or why is this showing off comes about? There are reasons for that. There are several reasons why human beings flaunt or show off themselves, but the most important among them is what is called as sexual selection. I'm not going to talk on sexual selection. If you really want to know the details of sexual selection, Tejas Finney can give, I'm sure, 1 hour talk on that. But I'll only tell just two elements of what is sexual selection. In fact, she did her PhD on sexual selection in plants. The two important elements of sexual selection are the following. One is that For whatever the reason, which of course you can now get later from her if you want to, females always choose for the male and not the males choose for the females. Females always select for the males. That is number one. And whom does the female choose? Female chooses the most strong and the most resourceful boy, a resourceful man. And so males are prompted to now compete among themselves to show off that I have more resources, I am more strong. And that's why we have peacock feathers, very elaborate, because the peacock males have to show off in front of the females that I am the better male than the other males. And that's how the flaunting has come about. Even in our Swayamvara, Sita Swayamvara, Draupadi Swayamvara, the males were asked to compete among themselves by throwing an arrow to the moving fish on the top, looking through the oil. So here again, there is a selection among the males, and male has to show his strength. This kind of show off of the males is now there even in different ways. People flaunt their muscular body, and in some situations people flaunt their wealth, the diamond studded cars or gold studded cars, etc. This is not human nature, it is animal nature. Birds do that. You look at the elaborate feathers of the birds here. So in other words, because males are selected to compete to appeal to the female, males are selected, or men have been selected to flaunt, and that is one of the reasons why human beings flaunt, human beings now show off. It is very difficult to be very simple when we have evolved like that. And in addition to this, in fact, even today in the tribal colonies of Africa, men in the event of Swayamvara still exists in some of the tribal colonies of Africa. Men dress up themselves, apply lipstick, wear a lot of necklaces like women do, wear beautiful hats, and go and present themselves in front of the woman. And woman now chooses among those boys the most well-dressed, most beautiful, and most adorned, more decorated, and more resourceful boy. So even today, this feature of showing off among the men is there because of sexual selection. So in other words, the exhibitionism of the human beings is there as a result of evolution. It is instinct to us, and this is against the principles of Gandhi, and Gandhi's teaching thus again seems to be antithetic to the process of evolution that we are all selected to be. Let us go to non-violence. And when we go to non-violence, again, there are different reasons why non-violence occurs. One among them is that there are non-violent fightings or killings going on within the same species. And why does it happen? It happens because there will be competition for the mates, as I just now told, or it could be also because the organisms or the animals are like dogs and birds have to fight for the food, that to acquire their food, or there is also fighting for territories as in monkeys. And so there is fighting and violence almost evolved throughout the evolution of the animal kingdom, and just as soldiers, as I told. There is another level of violence, and that is very important in this context. What is that? We now have become violent and killing, or have been selected to kill other organisms, other animals, other than our own species. And why has that evolved? Because of survival strategies. Take the example of a tiger killing a bison. Is it wrong that a tiger kills a bison? After all, that is the way it has evolved to. It is a predator. It has to now survive only by killing other animal. And that's how the whole web of life has evolved. The whole web of life says that you kill other an organism and live on it. And here is Gandhi telling, don't be violent. Now, as a matter of fact, all animals live by killing, and it is a living strategy. And the law of the jungle that is actually now seen as a web of life has been inherited even to the humankind, and humankind also has survived by eating all that is available to him throughout the human evolution. And so we have lived as hunters and gatherers, and in the process we have now always now tried to see all that we can eat, whether animal or plant, and eating meat was also a way of life. So violence is also there, non-vegetarianism is also there. But note that Gandhi proposed vegetarian principle, which is again antithetic to the very basic instinct in which we all have evolved. Compassion is also another component of that. And coming to the selfishness, and this perhaps is the final story that I'm going to tell. So Gandhi also told, don't be selfish. I took the example of honeybee in the very beginning and showed that honeybee's fight against the enemy is both violent and also sacrificing. So there was an element of sacrifice there in the honeybee that I told, but deep inside the sacrifice of honeybee, you will see that there is a selfishness. What is the selfishness? On attaching the enemy, the bee dies and bee sacrifices for the sake of the colony. This is how we interpret it. But is it really a sacrifice or it is something else? To be precise, it is not sacrifice at all. The reason is, by being, you know, a violent bee, the honeybee of course is killing itself, but it is protecting the entire colony, all of whom share the genes of this honeybee. So this honeybee, by killing itself, is saving all the hundreds of thousands of organisms which share its own genes, and by that, by sacrificing, it is conserving all those genes in its relatives. In that sense, it is not a sacrifice, it is a selfish act to make sure that all our genes are now saved in the colony. In other words, the honeybee's behavior is actually to save the thousands of colony members who share her own genes, and in that sense, it is not a sacrifice. It is, in fact, the extreme form of selfishness. Thus, by stinging the enemy, the honeybee is actually becoming or is showing it's the ultimate form of selfishness. In other words, in whichever way you see, whether you think it as a sacrifice or you think it as a selfish nature, in whichever way you see, life has evolved to be very selfish, very violent, and very cruel. Gandhi and Buddha, on the other hand, are preaching to go against all these things. Now, here lies the secret as to why Buddha and Gandhi have become famous. Why have they become famous? I like to now end my talk with one example. I'm sure all of you know the Punyakoti story here, right? I was told most of you either are from Karnataka or have already know the culture of Karnataka. Punyakoti story is a famous story, and I don't need to repeat. Tajaswini, should I repeat the story? Everyone should know. So I'll skip that. So the story, the poem starts from Dharani Mandala Madhyadalage, but somewhere in between there is a statement called ಸತ್ಯವೇ ನಮ್ಮ ತಾಯಿ ತಂದೆ ಸತ್ಯವೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಬಂಧು ಬಳಗ ಸತ್ಯ ವಾಕ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ತಪ್ಪಿ ನಡೆದರೆ ಮೆಚ್ಚನ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮನು. ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದಿ ಎಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಹೋಲ್ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ. ದೇರ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ಫ್ರೇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಮಿಡಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪೊಯಮ್. ಕಂಡ ವಿಧಿಕೋ ಮಾಂಸ ವಿಧಿಕೋ ಗುಂಡಿಗೆಯ ಬಿಸಿ ರಕ್ತ ವಿಧಿಕೋ ಚಂಡ ವ್ಯಾಗ್ರನ ನೀನಿದೆಲ್ಲವ ನುಂಡು ಸಂತಸ ನಿಂದಿರು. ನೌ ಗೋ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಟು ದ ಪ್ರೀವಿಯಸ್ ಸೆಂಟೆನ್ಸ್. ಸತ್ಯವೇ ನಮ್ಮ ತಾಯಿ ತಂದೆ ಸತ್ಯವೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಬಂಧು ಬಳಗ. Apparently, this Punyakoti story was enacted in front of Gandhi when once he came to Nandi Hills, on the top of Nandi Hills in the now Gandhi Hall or Nehru Hall there. This drama was enacted in front of him, and Gandhi apparently cried listening to the whole story. So he was very happy on two things. Number one, that this whole story preaches about the truth for which Gandhi, of course, stood for. And number two, he appreciated the sacrifice that the tiger did for saving the cow. Incidentally, I have named my daughter also as Punyakoti. So I am not against Punyakoti. But let us analyze this whole story in the context of evolution. If we carefully look at the whole story, we all cry when cow has to go back to the tiger, leaving its, you know, karu or the kid. And we all cry. In fact, I have cried when I was a small kid, and I made my daughter also cry when she was a small kid, and all of us perhaps have cried for this. But look at how biased we are all. We all cry when we know that cow is going to die, but we all feel happy when the lion or the tiger jumps from the mountain and saves the cow. None of us cry for the tiger that actually dies at the end. We all forget that tiger is also another organism or life or living organism like a cow, and we all want cow to survive because it gives us milk. We are not bothered about the tiger. After all, tiger's food is cow. And if cow has to survive, tiger has to sacrifice. So the story writer has made so interesting end that the tiger dies and the cow is saved. We are all happy. But are we right in our really not feeling for the death of the tiger? We all will be cruel. No sacrifice and cow should die because we are now discriminating there between two lives. And this is exactly what apparently Gandhi did. He appreciated the sacrifice of the tiger. And he told that he liked the story because of the statement of Satyavenamatayitande. In the entire story, all the philosophical disagreements that I so far told about the evolution and the Gandhian principles are hidden. We are all fooling ourselves by appreciating the fact that the tiger jumped from the mountain. We should be ashamed of the fact that we are happy that the tiger died. Because if we are really, we should care for the cow and the tiger equally well, and we should now perhaps feel good for both of them. Neither Gandhi nor any of us feel good for the tiger. We only feel good for the cow. And that is the dvandva of the philosophy that we are all appreciating with the with Gandhi and Buddha. I'll skip all this. I'll only come to the last and perhaps now reason out. I'll skip all this. I've told all this story. So if that is the case, why is that Gandhi and Buddha became so famous? Because the biological truth is that evolution has created a cruel world. If not for evolution, believe me, Gandhi and Buddha wouldn't have been appreciated. Why? Because we are all selfish, because we are all violent, because we are all cruel, because we are all, you know, not simple. They taught what we are not, and so Gandhi and Buddha became famous. They taught us something that we can't generally do, and they lived something that we all generally cannot do. And that's why Gandhi and Buddha became famous. In other words, Gandhi and Buddha should thank evolution, otherwise which they wouldn't have had any place at all. They told us what evolution has taught us, not to follow what evolution has taught us. And so their preaching has a value in our society. So Gandhi and Buddha's philosophy are accepted because they are trying to convert the man, the animal, and they are telling to tell us to be human, which we are not evolved into. We are all animals. We have evolved into an animal, animal kind. But Gandhi and Buddha told, no, don't be an animal, be a human. So they told us to go against the animal in us and to accept the human that we are not. And they fought their instincts and won over their own genes. The genetic nature of all of us and also of Buddha and Gandhi is that be violent, be selfish, and be greedy. They own their instincts. We, all of us cannot do that. And that's why Gandhi and Buddha are famous. They resisted to be the victims of evolution. We are all victims of evolution. And Gandhi and Buddha told, don't be the victims of evolution. And they preached, follow the path of cultural evolution. Don't follow the path of biological evolution. In short, if I have to state what Gandhi and Buddha preached us, it is this. Do not be the slave of evolution, but be the master of your conscience. And that is the preaching of Gandhi and Buddha, which is very difficult to follow. And that is why Gandhi and Buddha are famous. And today, if we are to celebrate Gandhi, I would say we should also celebrate the fact that we are a product of evolution. And if we were not to be the product of evolution, Gandhi and Buddha's role, preachings had no role at all. And so Gandhi and Buddha should thank the process of evolution because of evolution, their preachings have a value. And the value that perhaps makes the human animal into, sorry, man the animal into the humankind. Thank you very much. Hope,
Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us with your wisdom on the Gandhian philosophy in connection with the biological evolution. And at the end, you took us to our childhood memories with the Punyakoti story. I still remember Punyakoti story. And now I request our beloved director to give his remarks. Anybody wants to have some?
philosophy.
I appreciate your talk, you know, you are shown us the other side of the Gandhian thing. I have an hypothetical question. Had Gandhi studied evolution, because he studied law, yeah. And you know, he practiced as a lawyer. If had he studied evolution, he would have become a different human being. What is
fantastic, your... fantastic question. Please give him a big hand for this.
Because I have been following the Gandhian philosophy from the, you know, school days. Okay. And I have been reading the Ramachandra Guha and others who have written about Gandhiji.
Okay.
And I was, in fact, you opened my eyes, the other side, because you linked with the evolution, which is very important. And as you rightly mentioned, there is a lot of violence. And now you can see in Afghanistan, in all other countries, violence is, you know, the order of the day. And that is a human instinct and human nature. And why these two people like Gandhiji and Buddha become famous, that also you mentioned in your last slide. So my question is, I was thinking, had he studied evolution, and some biology, as you rightly mentioned in your thing, whether he would have become a different person.
Okay, there are two kinds of answers I can give. One is, if Gandhi is reborn again, would he become the same Gandhi again? No one knows about it, so we can't say. And then we are now putting another assumption, if he had studied evolution, maybe he would have become much more stronger Gandhi than what he was if he had studied evolution, because he then knew how difficult it is to now for us to follow the principles he so simply told. So maybe he would have become much more stronger. In fact, I mean, the reason why I requested all of them to clap for your question is the following. Of recently, there are these developments to now link up philosophy and evolution strongly. People know, in fact, the very cultural evolution, you know, our parents tell us, be a good man, be a good boy, don't steal from someone else. Please note that the very fact of stealing and taking away from someone else has come to us from evolution. So all the preachings, all the cultural things that we are told is against evolution. If we understand that, then, you know, we now consciously become what to control within ourselves and what not to control within ourselves. So maybe Gandhi would have become much more strong in his preachings than what he is if he had perhaps studied evolution and had known the reason why we are what we are.
Yeah. Ultimately, what is the take-home message you wanted to give?
No, the take-home message is really,
perplexed with.
Okay, my purpose today was the following, to now contradict as to why it is difficult to become a Gandhi again. I mean, why to contrast evolution and Gandhi, and then to now analyze why everyone cannot become Gandhi. And number two, also to analyze why Gandhi and Buddha have become famous. As I told, if not for evolution, Gandhi and Buddha had no role at all in our cultural evolution. Because we all are shaped to be bad we are shaped to be bad through evolution. There is a place for preachers like Buddha, Gandhi, or any such great people. Otherwise, they have no role at all. So they exist because of the fact that evolution existed. An analysis that I thought is something to be importantly realized. Yeah.
So thank you very much for your wonderful lecture, sir. I have been your student, actually. I was your student during my days in GPB, West Bangalore.
And now I believe you are my student.
Yeah. So my question is, sir, most of the Gandhian principles and preachings came out of the struggle for quality life, a struggle for social rights, fundamental rights, than the survival tactics that happens in the evolutionary or biological evolution. So I still find there is a boundary between Gandhian principles being applied to this quality of life and social justice, fundamental rights, than to the survival tactics.
Okay. Please note that the social rights and all that came towards the end of his life. They are not as much of a Gandhian philosophy as they are consequence of a Gandhian thinking. You know what I mean? When the governance has to be established in the country, those principles were brought out of... And again, Gandhi never... I would say Gandhi never taught them as governing principles. It is the Ambedkar who now brought it out, and Gandhi support that strongly, and Gandhi of course also promoted that. However, you are on one way right, you know, when he adapted the life of simplicity, when he adapted the lack of boundaries between the groups, he in fact now promoted this idea of equality and all that, which again is anti-evolutionary. Please believe that. Please believe that. You know, human, anything that humans have now struggled to now adapt is the reason is behind, the reason behind that is that we are a product of evolution where all these hierarchies have been there. You take a monkey's colony. In monkey's colony, there is what is called as an alpha monkey. An alpha monkey, when it is now moving around like a gadwa, every other monkey has to give way for it. If there is a monkey that has found a food in the tip of a branch, and if gadawa monkey goes, it has to simply fold its tail, leave the way, place for it, and get off from that branch where the food is there. So this feudalism, the inequality and power showing off, this is all there as a consequence of evolution. And even that, for that matter, though of course in the beginning Gandhi did not spoke about it, is also something that is anti-evolutionary and very difficult to follow, in other words.
It is not the Gandhian philosophy. I wanted to know what your inspirational talk, whether violence leads to in your that is one is a Ashoka.
Your first question, does violence lead to peace? Okay, in evolution there is no place for peace at all. In evolution there is no place for peace at all. If anything, if there is an opportunity available to me, I would rather now make you the weaker or in any way subordinate to me and win over you. And peace comes to me only when I now take over you, but there will be someone else who will be now wanting to take over me. So in evolution there is no place for peace at all. That is point number one. Coming to your second thing, you know, Ashoka, yes, you are right. He is also called Chand Ashoka. So later he became Dharma Ashoka or Dharma Ashoka. But there are also controversies again on that, whether he now converted, became a Dharma Ashoka because of the war that he fought and where he saw the blood and all that. Note that even before the war, even before he became the king, he had married a Buddhist lady called Mahadevi, who actually built this Sanchi stupa, and he had now donated to all that, and the son that he sent to Sri Lanka is actually the son of this Mahadevi. So he was a Buddhist even before the war. So Ashoka was following the principles of Buddhism even before the war, and much earlier to the time period that people say he converted into Buddhism. So there are historical errors that we have been taught with about his conversions. Yeah.
So I am Dr. Dhananjay. I am also your student.
Yeah.
I took 2-3 courses, and many times I used to remember your whatever that, like you mentioned in your talk, the sexual selection and other things. I have a just point to hear from you that whether evolution has increased the violence, and there are forces which try to reduce the degree of violence through means of Buddha.
I think you should all give a big clap to this question. Very good question, Dhananjaya. I'm sure you also might have heard my last class in the evolution called cultural evolution. You know, just as biological evolution has a force that has shaped the entire living system, from the monkeys onwards, there is another process of evolution called cultural evolution. And this cultural evolution includes several things. One example is, for instance, using of the sticks to now take out the prey from the termite colony. You might have seen the famous video where a chimpanzee uses a long stick, puts the stick into the termite colony. Lot of termites get onto the stick. It takes it out and wipes on its mouth. All the termites come into its mouth. So also, a bird that takes a stone and beats nut to break the copra inside that. These are all beginnings of cultural evolution. The cultural evolution also includes the way we bury our dead. Elephants actually bury the dead body in a very pick, in a particular way. So these are all elements of cultural evolution. Cultural evolution has now taken over the biological evolution sometime in the process of this evolution. The moment social groups began to evolve, when I say social groups, where several generations live together. In chimpanzees, the parents and the sons and the grandsons, they all live together. So whenever the society began to emerge, social group began to emerge, cultural evolution has come about. Because organisms have realized that irrespective of the knowledge of biological evolution, that we are violent, we are cruel, we are selfish, and that is costing to the survival of the group. And so some amount of sacrifice has to be done, some amount of non-violence has to be done. So cultural evolution is shaping us in the last 1 lakh year or 10 lakh years. And Buddha and Gandhi are a continuum of this cultural evolution. So it's not that Gandhi and Buddha are distinct, but in the process of this cultural evolution, they have now raised new flags, they have put new milestones in the evolution of humankind.
Sir, in this cultural evolution, that man to become human being, there will always be conflict between cultural evolution and biological evolution. They have different loggerheads always.
That's why I told, because they are loggerheads, someone who preaches them becomes very famous, like Gandhi and Buddha. And more and more these preachings come, more and more these things are built into our culture, into our society, more and more perhaps we become more human. But there are also these commercial things that are now acting against it now. In fact, in the cultural evolution, there are two opposing ends. One is the human nature to become good, another is the commercial nature to become bad. So in the cultural evolution, there is also this commercial nature which is making us very bad. So we don't know where we all are going to. And that's why there is place for these people like Gandhi, Buddha. Yeah.
All the world orders and also the amendments to various constitutions are to bring the
our wise nature of converting our actions into correct. You are right. So they're all consequences.
Hello.
Of yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Online. Yeah. Yeah.
Sir, hello, sir. It is very good talk, and we are viewing your talk online.
Okay.
Just I had a question. I just had a view that Gandhi and Buddha has realized that human has evolved psychologically.
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that. I didn't say Gandhi and Buddha realized that. If I have told so, I am wrong. Yeah.
And they can break this biological instinct because of their mind. So that's the reason I think they have said all these preachings. That's what my...
Okay. Let us put it this way. Gandhi and Buddha did not know about evolution, but they knew that irrespective of what the... how man has come about, man has these animalistic features. And so they told... elements that are not animalistic and that are perhaps anti-evolutionary. So I did not say that Gandhi and Buddha knew about evolution having shaped humans to be so bad and cruel and violent. Yeah. Yeah.
Violence. If violence was there in the evolution, if it had to continue, finally at the end, only one super person, because violence will finish everything. Finally, all species, everything has to go, only one which is the fittest has to survive. Everything will vanish in the universe. Is it the principle of evolution, violence?
Again, a very good question indeed. Okay, let me now rephrase what you told and let me see if I'm correct. Your point is, if violence is a consequence of evolution, it has to persist because eventually the super organism has to survive. That is what your point is, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
But actually, it is also possible that with the evolution of the brain, which can analyze the evolution, and which can also analyze the consequence of the damage of the violence, we can now think of a different path of evolution, that is cultural evolution, wherein a super organism can come about which is more peaceful than violent. Yes. So that is also a possibility. And I hope that will perhaps now move ahead. And in which case, a situation will come where we don't need Buddha and Gandhi.
Can also be like the honeybee. Yeah. The evolution need not be only for the superhuman. It's also like collective of genes want to be surviving also. May not be the one one individual or the one
species.
One species.
Yeah, Tejasvini, in essence, it happens that a set of genes which he calls superhuman and you calls a set of genes. So eventually his point and your point are coinciding there. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much again.
Very good afternoon to all of you, and I think all of you who joined offline and online, believe me that this was one of those thinking, rekindling what we thought about Gandhi, Buddha, and violence, non-violence. I found the answer today why he was called Gandhi in his campus. He is against evolution. He wanted all of you to be in presence. That is one thing. In a later one, sir. And it was really thought-provoking. And it put many of you, and including me, in perplexion, what he wanted to convey. Thinking, that's what is required. And we have to read in between the lines of the preachings of Gandhi or Buddha, rather than to follow exactly the verbatically, the alphabetically, what it was. And adopt our behavior, also the deeds, based on the practicality and what is the situation. That's what is most important, rather than verbatically follow their preaching. That is my thinking, that is my thought. I was thinking when we invited him, also I heard a couple of his presentation, lectures, a couple of books also I read. He will show one particular monumental Gandhi slide when it comes to talking about Gandhi's philosophy and science. That is the Gandhi peeping into the microscope. That is one of the iconic pictures that we have today when we want to connect Gandhi to the science. This is one of those pictures which moved me also. Many of people, jokingly they used to say, Gandhi is finding the truth through the microscope, what he is proud. But the things are different. The stories of Punyakoti, many of us know, just to give a message that non-violence is important. At the same time, there is the requirement of sacrifice. He connected just with the two words to the theory of evolution. That is the strength of Dr. Ganeshaya. And I thank you very much for accepting our invitation, giving us a thought-provoking. And I am really sad that many of our administrative people are not here. That would have given them thinking what should be, how to behave, what to go about, how to assist our people, how to bring about the science forward. With these few remarks, I thank Jayantimala also to conducting this very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our beloved director to kindly honor Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya, sir. Thank you, sir. Now it's time to propose a vote of thanks. Our sincere gratitude to today's chief guest, Professor Dr. K.N. Ganeshaya, for graciously accepting our invitation and sharing his wonderful insights and wisdom with all of us. I express my sincere thanks to our beloved director, Dr. B.N.S. Muthi, for making this event possible. And I should express my sincere thanks to Dr. Agora, PME Chairman, for his constant guidance on this arranging this guest lecture. I also express my thanks to Dr. Tejaswini, Dr. K.V. Ravishankar, sir, and the head extension and canteen nodal officer for their kind help in arranging this lecture. I thank all the my team members, Swachhata Pakhwada team, and all the audience for your gracious presence here. Thank you, one and all. Jai Hind.